evening, Oakwood. Let's all stand and worship.
Every secret, every shame, every fear, every pain, live inside the dark, but that's not who we are. We are children of the day. So wake up, sleeper, lift your head. We were meant for more than this. Fight the shadows, conquer death. Make the most of the time we have left. We are the light of the world. We are the city on a hill. We are the light of the world. We gotta, we gotta, we gotta let your light shine. We are the light of the world. We are the city on a hill. We are the light of the world. We gotta, we gotta, we gotta let your light shine. Let your light shine, let your light shine.
Praise today. Amen. God is good. Somebody say amen today. Hey, we got a few announcements before we get back to the next part of our service, as Joe is not here today, so I'll be taking over, and so I'll show you how it's done. But no, we love Joe and everything he does. Amen. We love him. And so I'm just covering for him today. But anyways, here's some of the announcements for us. It says, join the women's ministry for breakfast at the First Watch Ann Arbor restaurant at $5 White Elephant gift. So $5 White Elephant gift. You guys are going to be doing that exchange on that Saturday, December 17th at 7:30 a.m. Is that a typo? I wouldn't go if I were you. But don't... We're recording, so 7:30 a.m. be there, December 17th in the morning, or be asleep, whichever you prefer. RSVP at go.oakwoodchurch.org/breakfast. We got another one. Join us on Sunday, December 18th. This is going to be something we're doing for the church. And every year we have it where Santa Claus comes in and we get to do, you know, some Christmas caroling. But we're going to do the same thing this year, just a little bit kind of more laid back. It's going to be here the 18th, next Sunday, 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. It's just going to be a cookie exchange. We're going to sing some carols, have a good time. And yes, Santa Claus is going to be there. So it's going to be a great time. Pastor Frank is going to go ahead and read a special song, a special book to the children like he always does. Now, here's the big one. So everybody focus on this one, because this is a big announcement. Due to some of the conflicts, Pastor Frank will be out of town. It is New Year's Eve day. There's some other events going on, and what is going on December 31st, we are not having service. Okay, does everybody hear that? because you are our Saturday service. So everybody shaking the hands. If you're with us online and you're coming December 31st, we are off. Enjoy New Year's. A lot of people go have fun, have partying. There's a big Michigan game. There's other games. We won't talk of Rusty Weigel. But enjoy time with the pastors out of towns. But we are still having service New Year's Day to break in the new year. So come join with us. We'll pack this room full, but that's okay. We'll sit in the aisles if we have to. Amen. You got some more events that we're doing at the church you want to check out, go to oakwoodchurch.org. Check it out on our website or check it out on our app. Now is the most important part of the announcements. I know you wait the whole time just to hear this. Would you turn around, shake someone's hand, and welcome them to Oakwood today? Come on.
Is the battle you see my victory? When all I see is a mountain, you see a mountain move. And as I walk through the shadow, your love surrounds me. There's nothing to fear now, for I am safe with you.
Come on, church, together.
So when I fight, I fight on my knees with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet. I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. Oh,
here we go.
And if you are for me, who can be against me? For Jesus, there's nothing impossible for you. Belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet. fight on my knees with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet. I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. Oh God, the battle belongs to you.
Yeah, it's somebody out there today. Thank you, Jesus, so much. Thank you, Jesus, so much. We ask to build our life upon your foundation, Lord. Our lives upon who you are and who you are in our life. And we celebrate 25 years as a church tomorrow. And this song, it just grabs everything we've ever had in our lives. And that's why we're still a church, because we have built this church upon his foundation. We have built this church upon his truth. That's why we're still a church, because that truth that you read about and that word and that Bible and that book, well, it says that no matter what may come, the truth prevails. When the final verse is read, when the final words are said, and the final breath is breathed in this earth, it says that truth prevails. Take hope in that today, church. Amen. Yeah. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you, ain't that true? We live for you, yeah. And Jesus, a name above every other name. Jesus, the only one that could ever say, worthy, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you, and that is true. We live for you. Come on, one people. Oh, holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are, and fill me with your heart, and lead me in your love to those around me. Jesus, a name above every other name. Let's proclaim that today. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. Holy, holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show.
In you alone, and I will not be shaken, for I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you alone. kitchen, and I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken. Come on.
Woo. You know, when we come before a holy God, we come before a holy God and we speak his name. When we pray before a holy God and we take our lives and put it before him, you know you don't have to put on that act. You know that? No, no, no. See, we so often we go to work, we go to school, we go do things in our life, and we put on this mask, we put on this act like we're someone else. That a lot of times when we're by ourselves, well, we seem to be a little different, we feel a little different, we act a little different. And I tell you what, when you want to have a life that emulates him, you have to have your real heart before him. Because when you are in the presence of a holy God, there is no part of your life that hides from him. There is no part of your life that you can mask from him, that you can put on an act in front of him, because he knows you at your most vulnerable state. But he still loves you. And it says right now, when you pray, when I pray, the word of God says the heart of worship. When Jesus is talking to the Samaritan woman, he says a true heart of worship is spoken in truth. And who is truth? Jesus. Jesus is truth. God is truth. His word is truth. And so when you pray, maybe say, God, show me your heart, but then show me my heart. Because my heart wants to be one with yours. Not the act that I put on. Because see, the act that I put on, it's just going to keep being fake. The act that you put on is going to keep being an act. But when you stop before a holy God and you speak his name over people, you speak his name over your life, it's not the ooh, weird Christian thing. It's speaking truth into a broken world filled with lies, filled with darkness, filled with no hope. It's pouring hope into a cup that needs it, right? And we call upon the name of Jesus Christ today, and I want to speak that over you, and I want to pray that over you, and I want to believe that over you today, and I want you to feel that presence. But it starts with you to receive that and to come back to that heart of worship that Jesus says is spoken when you let your real self be there. You don't have to be somebody else when you're in his presence. Be yourself and realize you're loved and give him what is so rightfully his. I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind. 'Cause I know there is peace within his presence. I speak Jesus.
I just want to speak the name of Jesus till every dark addiction starts to break, declaring there is hope and there is freedom. I speak Jesus.
Your name is power, your name is healing, your name is life. Break every stronghold, shine through the shadows, burn like a fire.
Come on.
I just want to speak the name of Jesus, don't you? Over fear and all anxiety, till every soul held captive by depression, I speak Jesus. 'Cause your name is power, your name is healing.
Come on,
your name is life.
Do you believe?
Stronghold, shine through the shadows, burn like a fire.
shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. And Jesus for my family, I speak his holy name, Jesus. Ooh, you got those goosebumps today? Come on, come on. Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. And Jesus for my family, that's you, I speak his holy name, Jesus. Let's lift it up today, God's children, yeah. Shout Jesus from the mountains, and Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. And Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus, Jesus. Your name is power,
hey.
Your name is healing, your name is life,
above all else it's life.
Break every stronghold, shine through the shadows,
Jesus been good in your life. Can somebody attest to that today?
Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. And Jesus for my family,
hey,
I speak his holy name, Jesus.
The mountains tremble when you proclaim that name. The demons flee.
Shout Jesus from the mountains, and Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. And Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus. Shout Jesus from the mountains, and Jesus in the street, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. And Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus. Oh, it's Jesus.
Just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind, 'cause I know there is peace within his presence. I speak Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I speak Jesus over my family, over the children of this church, the believers in this room. I speak Jesus in the darkest part of your life. Speak Jesus right now, church. Come on, don't you feel it? We speak Jesus over our lives today, our friends, our life, our job, our money, our people, God, the outreach of this church. Since day one of Oakwood Baptist Church, going old school, calling it that, from day one we have spoken the name of Jesus.
Yeah, that's worth clapping about today. That's worth coming alive today. That's worth giving him praise today. That's worth coming alive today. Thank you, Lord, so much today that we just get to be your people. And I just want to thank you for who you are and just the presence. The presence. Your presence changes all things. In a moment where I felt down, in a moment that I felt hurt, in a moment I felt afraid, all it took was your presence. All it took was your presence, your breath. It says all we have to do is reach out and touch your robe. It's all we got to do. And it says that the healing in our life begins by speaking truth. Our pastor comes to speak. God, we ask that you'd anoint his words. We ask that you would bless the offering, bless our people. And one more time, we thank you so much for the 25 years that you've given us as a family. Amen, as a family. And Lord, we just ask that you would be here today. We pray this in your mighty name. And all God's children said amen. Let's give a round of applause now to God for his goodness, for still being here and still on his throne. You may be seated, church. This is where we're going to take our offering. And if you're joining with us online, we'd love to have you. This is a week that we get to celebrate 25 years. You've heard us talk about it week in and week out, but this is the week that we get to do it. And so just be sending prayers and sending love. But we love you guys so very much.
Christmas gospel celebrating this time called Christmas. Every man and woman sitting in here understands that when it comes to Christmas, it's kind of up to us to help little people understand what Christmas is all about. It's really important for us as adults to remind ourselves that Jesus is the reason for the season, correct? Because it gets really simply easy to involve ourselves in the insanity of everything that's going on with Christmas. Do I have enough money to pay the bills? Can I get the stuff that I want to get? Can I do what I need to do? Can I run over and get this? Am I going to order something? Is it going to get here in time? And I kind of get away from what I'm supposed to be doing. How many of you in this room are professional gift wrappers? How many of your gifts look like garbage? How many of you have just resorted to just buying a bag and sticking it in a bag? And there you go. Okay. Amen. It's up to us. We sit down and we say Christmas either is turned into something that is all about something it's not, or it's turned in or turned back to something that it is. How we do that is by taking parts of Christmas and reminding ourselves, this is what it's for. This is why I'm doing it. The characters that are involved. Last week it was Mary. This week it is the shepherds. And sitting down and dealing with that and just putting it into the context of where it really is. I said that last week, that just me putting a picture on the screen of who Mary really was just goes so against some of the things that we've been raised in. And talking about, you know, what the barn really looked like and what really took place there. And so if I can take a part of that tonight and use it in a proper sense, I will do that also. We start in Luke chapter 2, verse 6 through 7, most popular section of scripture for Christmas that there is. It says, "And while they were there, the time came for her baby to be born. She gave birth to her firstborn son. She wrapped him snugly in strips of cloth and laid him in a manger because there was no lodging available for them." Most of you would remember this in the King James Version, that there was no room in the inn, and that produces a whole lengthy discussion on what was going on and why. But I would like to put before you that this date of what I just read to you was ordained, and it was planned. It was ordained and planned exactly at the very right time, the very right place, and in the very right circumstances. And so just dealing with saying that those things were ordained and those things were planned, and then using the word I did in my notes exactly to say the right time exactly, pushes borders. So if you will allow me to do that tonight, in Galatians chapter 4 and verse 4, Paul was writing a letter to the people of Galatia. He was in a discussion with them over the arguments of whether they were people of the law or whether they were people in freedom and which side they were born from. And in the middle of chapter 4, verse 4, he says, "But when the right time came," and if you have your notes with you, underline the right time. "When the right time came, God sent his son, born of a woman, subject to the law." He came at just the right time in God's redemptive plan, when the world was perfectly prepared. And if you are not a historian, it's not something you would have ever put together, but you need to put it together so that you can understand God's timing. He came when God's work of redemption would have fit perfect into the world that it came into. The time that he came was called Pax Romana. And it literally was when Rome ruled the known world. And when I use the term Pax Romana, it means peace that existed between all these different nationalities, because all of these groups were under Roman rule. Not only were they under Roman rule, but there were garrisons there, and so they kept everyone in order. You got in a fight, you acted up, you were a black person fighting a brown person, or a brown person fighting a white, or whatever group you were dealing with, a Roman soldier stepped in to end what was going on. So peace reigned. Travel and commerce were possible in a way that it had never been possible before because of all the roads that had been put in. Rome was known for building roads to bring its empire together. So the whole empire was linked in a way that people could travel, and they could travel safely without being attacked. That was unknown of back then. Also, language was all under one language, the Greek language. That was the business language of the world. Everyone spoke it, so all the confusion that used to be with people trying to talk with each other was gone. In spite of all of that advancement, the world was in the greatest need that it had ever been in. The whole civilized earth, and it's kind of funny how people take today and all the different issues that go on in our society that has become worse than nasty with pedophilia and homosexuality and a ton of other things that we argue and debate about, and then try to say that the world has never been like that. Well, they never understood the Roman Empire. Because the Roman Empire had gone down into paganism that was beyond vulgar, and the cult groups and the pagan groups were so disgusted by everything, they were screaming for change. There was a spiritual hunger in the world that the world had never known, and it became the perfect time for Jesus Christ to walk into the scene for both Jews and Gentiles. Again, if you don't know those terms, if you've never heard Gentile, if you're not a Jew, anyone in this room Jewish? We have any Jewish folks here sitting here? Okay, so all of you-ins are Gentiles. Everyone understand that? So red, yellow, black, and white, if you're not a Jew, you're a Gentile. Okay, cool, you got that. The verse says, "But when the right time came, God sent his son, born of a woman, subject to the law." So he was born as a Jew. If you put this grammatically, when it says the right time came, God sent his son, born of a woman, subject to the law. Wait, are we talking about her or him? The subject matter is the son. So the subject matter, the son, him being born under the law, meant that he was born to redeem those that were under the law. He was also born a man, so he could redeem both men and women as Jews and Gentiles. And he was born as God, so he would have the power and resources to do all that. Is everyone up to snuff on what I'm saying? Okay, good. How many of you know how to take notes? Okay, good. Get ready to take notes. Not only is all that going, but there is a 483-year period of time that the clock is ticking, and it's getting near running out. Daniel had prophesied that the Anointed One was coming, and Daniel had predicted down to the day that the Anointed One was coming, and that time was running out. Your Bible says in Daniel chapter 9, verse 25, and all the verses around it are important. I'll quote those. You can read them later. He says, "Now listen and understand." That's a very nice way in the Hebrew of saying, please pay attention. So, seven sets of seven plus 62 sets of seven will pass from the time the command is given to rebuild Jerusalem until a ruler, the anointed one, comes. Jerusalem will be rebuilt with streets and strong defenses despite the perilous times. Stop before we rip it apart and just deal with this. Listen and understand. Seven sets of seven plus 62 sets of seven. Definitive time. Then he said a ruler was going to come. Then he said Jerusalem will be rebuilt. Streets, that's the inner part of the city. Strong defenses in the original Hebrew, that's the walls and the moat that went around everything to protect it. And then he said, despite the perilous times. So this city, these walls, this temple, these homes will all be rebuilt in the middle of a time when it's not logical for them to be rebuilt. And oh, dealing with specifics, it's going to happen when seven sets of seven plus 62 sets of seven will pass from the time before this goes down. Everyone got that? Okay, so you're good at numbers. Seven sets of seven is 49. Okay, the big technical question. Six sets of seven are 434. 49 and 434 make... I'm not giving you more new answers. Good grief. Okay, here's what's important. Since none of you are Jewish, if I say Sabbath day to every single one of you sitting in this room, you are smart enough because you've heard it enough to go, Sabbath day is for what group of people? Jews. Okay, we all understand that in their system, they worked for 6 days and then they rested and they called that the Sabbath day, correct? Okay, to all of your English dudes and dudettes, and all of us wonderful people that think a certain way, we think of our life and our world, we don't go over and think where we should think. Why I said that is because in their world, they commonly dealt with sevens. That was part of their life. They understood that they worked for 6 days and they rest on the Sabbath. But not only did they have a Sabbath day, they had a Sabbath year. They were supposed to work the ground for 6 years. And on the seventh year, there was a Sabbath year, they didn't rest the ground. So they were supposed to grow crops for those first six and then not for the seventh one. And that's one of the least popular things in context of study of what you're dealing with. But we have to be able to say, wait. Listen and understand, seven sets of seven plus 62 sets of seven. I don't get exactly what you're talking here. Write in your notes someplace, he is referring to years. Not days. The only place in the book of Daniel where the word day is used instead of years is in chapter 10 when it says that Daniel was praying and the angel said, for 21 days I have been trying to come, Shabuah. I've been trying to be with you for 21 solid days. Again, that's a three sets of seven. These were numbers they dealt with. These were numbers they understood. Okay, back to what we're dealing with. They have been in bondage for 70 years. For 70 years, they're listening now to Daniel say, you remember what got talked about a long time ago? The book of 2 Chronicles alludes to this. You were taken out of where you were because you chose to live in sin. I looked at you and said, I want you to work 6 years, and on the seventh, I want you to let the ground rest. So you'll understand the world that they lived in, a world of greed. They went, wait. We're making $50,000 a year doing our crops. So if I don't work that year, I'm only going to make $300,000 in six when I could work the seventh and make $350,000. I'm losing $50,000. And God looked at them and said, yo, stupid, if you do what I ask you to do, I bless you. How many of you understand that principle in Scripture? Okay, you ready? Watch it. See, sometimes it's real easy for us to look back at Bible people and go, what, were you stupid? He marched them out of Egypt, and they went through the Red Sea. I mean, so many Christians that would go, oh, I just don't get it. Why did they have to go through all the plagues and all the stuff? I would have just done what I would know. You would have died in the wilderness like everyone else did. And if you want proof of it, when we sit and go, well, they were supposed to work 6 years and not the seventh, and by not going on the second, they lose $50,000. Oh, my goodness. And he said, no, why didn't they just trust God with the six? Why don't you trust God with your tithe? Why don't we look at God and say, you said to give 10% of my money. So you want me to live on 90% of my money. I really need that 10%. When God looks at you and says, Do you want me to bless you? I can do things on your land in 6 years that you can never do in seven. A little business in America called Chick-fil-A. How many of you like going to them? How many of you feel that's God's restaurant when you arrive? They work 6 days. They don't work seven. Do you know the flack they take in the news media over doing that? But do you know now in the United States of America, they're the third largest food chain? And no one's ever gotten to the fast food chain as fast as they have. And in the world, they're growing like a house of fire. But they're working one less day than everyone else is working and making more money than everyone else is making. When do we as Christians, modern time, when do we as Christians go, you know what, God, since you know everything, if you want me bankrupt, I'll be bankrupt. If you want me poor, I'll be poor. But you said, if I would give to you, you would bless me. He said to them, if you work 6 days and take the seventh off, I'll bless you. If you harvest the ground for 6 years and on the seventh don't, I will bless you. So because you messed with me, I took you out of your place for 70 years. Oh, so you get the number so you understand it. That's the 1 year for every set of seven that they should have been there. And so during that 490 years period, there should have been a 70-year break. They never took it. He's now making them take it. So this 70 period of seven times multiplying it out, 490 years, he looked at him and said, because you did that, I am now going to take 490 years in the verse before and after this verse. I am going to take 490 years, cut it out of your history. And in the end of that, I'm going to bring everlasting righteousness and holiness that you will never understand because you won't be there. And if you want to be able to figure out what's going down, Gabriel stood there and looked at him and said to Daniel, Daniel, seven sets of seven plus 62 sets of seven will go by, and then the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords will walk onto the planet and will change this world for eternity. Guys, I hate to break it to you. That's a little too stinking specific just to go, oh, well, I wonder if that really happened. So we get to figure it out because we're now on the other end of it. So if I take the times and the dates and put it all together, this is what I get. If I deal with the 62 and the 7, that comes to 69. If I multiply that times 7, that comes to 483 years. We know from history that Jerusalem was set and said to be rebuilt by a king named Artaxerxes in Persia in 445 B.C., He stood up with Nehemiah and made the declaration. We even know the date. Nehemiah said that it was on the month of Nisan, that's March. All the scholars that have gone through everything it has to do with Persia said that the declaration was made on the 14th of 445 BC. That's the date that the 483 years started for the anointed one to show up on the day that it said he would show up. Now, everyone in this room that's a Christian, please say amen. So you count the anointed one as who? At Jesus Christ, correct? So on one day, a person showed up riding a colt, and his name was Jesus. And when he marched into Jerusalem, the Jews there came before him and cried, Hosanna, blessed is the King of Israel that cometh in the name of the Lord. And they laid palm branches at his feet, and they took their coats off, and they laid their coats off at his feet. Is this the right day? You go, well, how do I know it's the right thing? In the version that I just read to you, the New Living Translation, it says the anointed one would come. Every other version that you read says what the original Greek said, Messiah, the prince, would come. It does not say Messiah, the king, would come because Jesus Christ has not won the king position yet. It does not say Messiah, the baby, would come. That would be when Jesus was born in Bethlehem. That doesn't fit. The time's not right, and it doesn't say that. It doesn't say the child Messiah would come. That would have put him at about 12 years of age. That wouldn't have fit. It didn't say Messiah, the preacher, would come. It said Messiah, the prince, would come. He rode over the hill on a colt, and the people stood looking at him saying, Hosanna, and Hosanna means pray, save us. It was a Hebrew phrase that was literally a cry for help. What were they crying for help for? Because they were surrounded by the Roman Empire, and they thought that when the Messiah came, he was going to break the back of Rome, and they were accepting Jesus Christ as the one that was going to destroy the Roman Empire. You want proof of that? They laid palms at his feet. The reason why they laid palms at his feet is because anytime a king came in from a battle and was victorious, they laid those at his feet. They also took their jackets off and laid their jackets at his feet. Why did they do that? You ever seen that dingy little thing we have where Hollywood stars show up and we do red carpet? Or somebody comes from a foreign country and we do red carpet when they're coming off the plane? They were doing the exact same thing. They didn't want the leader and the head of all's feet to touch dirty ground. Does that date work? Because believe it or not, we even know the day that he came. See, the pagans used a calendar of 365 days before we had our 365 days. The ancient Jews used what was called a schematic calendar. It was a 30-day calendar, 12 months times 30, 360 days. So you have 360 days times 483 years. That equals 173,880. How many of you got that? Cool, you're good. We can see by looking at the Jewish calendar when the Passovers took place that Jesus Christ on that colt rode over that hill on April the 6th, 32 AD. Does that work? March the 14th, 445 BC to April the 6th, 32 AD is only 477 years and 24 days. That's off by a few years. But you have to remember that they changed the calendar. They changed the calendar so 1 BC and 1 AD is the exact same years. So it's only off 476 years and 24 days. Then you got to convert it to the new system. The new system is 360 days to 365 days. So 365 times 476 plus the 24 days, and it's minus just a few hours, but that's okay, equals 173,764. That's short. Oh, wait a minute. Time out. How many of you ever heard of that wonderful little thing called leap years? It happens how often? Every four. So in that period of time, you had 119 of them. You have to add 119 days. That makes 173,883 days. But the number was 173,880. And see, some Christians go, well, that's close enough for me. Not for me. Any of you have OCD like I do? So I couldn't handle that. Because it's going to have to be exact or I got a problem. So there was a whole bunch of smart guys about 50 years ago in a royal observatory in England that said this doesn't work. So they started going through the solar calendar and started making calculations, and they found out something. They found that 1 1/28th of a day longer than that time on the solar calendar means that every 128 years you have to lose a day in the calendar system. So that comes to 3 point something, which when I told you the 24 days, there's a slight few hour variance of that, which means you take that off, plus the 2 hour variance, and you come up to 173,880 days that the anointed one, the Messiah of Jesus, walked on to the Prince of Peace at 483 years to the day. And some dingy named Daniel talking to an angel said that. And if you go, I didn't understand any of that, cool. Go research your little heart out. You'll find 3 different ways that they try to come up with the answer. All 3 ways come up with the exact same answer. It doesn't matter which way they go. There's an argument on what day is this and what day is that, and every single one of them come out with the same thing, that Jesus Christ arrived on April the 6th, 32 AD, as Messiah the Prince. And then Jesus confirmed it. When they started crying, Hosanna, blessed is the King, the Pharisees that were standing around yelled at him, Rabbi, rebuke your disciples. They have no business saying that. He said something that was beyond powerful. He looked at them and said, if they stop speaking, the stones are going to cry out. How many of you wish they would have stopped speaking? And if you want the confirmation of Jesus, after he said that to the Pharisees, he rode over the hill and he looked into the city. And the Bible says, as he came closer to Jerusalem and saw the city ahead, he began to weep. And he said, how I wish today that you of all people would understand the way to peace. Gabriel told Daniel that I was coming, and you've missed it. And now it's too late. And the peace that you're supposed to get is hidden from your eyes. When he said that the date that was given them was fulfilled in me, and you've missed it. Not only did he come at the right time, he came in the right place. The Bible says, but you, O Bethlehem Ephrathah, you're only a small village among all the people of Judah. Yet a ruler of Israel whose origins are in the distant past will come from you on my behalf. Bethlehem, house of bread. Its ancient name, Ephrathah, it means fruitful. You, the place that's fruitful, the house of bread, will produce the bread of life. When the wise men showed up and they told King Herod, we have seen the signs in the sky, the king called together the priests and the teachers and said, when does the word say that he would be born? Where does it put him? And they said, in the city of Bethlehem. The house of bread would produce the bread of life. Not only was it at the right time in the right place, it was in the right circumstance. And this one's a little more fun for us as Christians. That night, there were shepherds staying in the fields nearby, guarding their flocks of sheep. Suddenly, an angel of the Lord appeared among them, and the radiance of the Lord's glory surrounded them, and they were terrified. How many of you remember it in this version? And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which will be to... How many of you remember that version when you were growing up? Yeah, me too. But you see, what's powerful about this is reading it in words that we all understand a little easier. That night, there were shepherds staying in the field nearby. This is important. Don't miss this. That night, there were shepherds staying in the field nearby, guarding their flocks of sheep. Suddenly, an angel of the Lord appeared. All of us English readers, we go, oh, the important part is the angel of the Lord appeared. And the radiance shone around. The terrified part doesn't get us because that would have terrified us too. How many of you, if you were in a shepherd and an angel poured up and all those things, you would have just died of a heart attack right there? Okay, so see, for our world, we don't go, oh, wow. We go, oh, it's that. But any Jew reading this would go, oh, no, something's not right. Because when we go, the night there were shepherds staying in the fields nearby guarding their flocks of sheep, we think American. We think the little house and the little barn and the fenced area and the sheep and the cattle were lowing, whatever lowing is. Nearby doesn't mean anything to us. We just think of it as American. Yeah, the sheep would have been right over there. Uh-uh. Because they lived in a time of Pharisees under what was called the oral tradition. Not only did they have the law that they had to keep the oral tradition, and the oral tradition was written in a book called the Jewish Mishnah, so you can go read it right now, if you could read Hebrew. The Jewish Mishnah had a regulation. This was the regulation. It forbid the keeping of flocks of sheep throughout the land of Israel. So no sheep could have been nearby Bethlehem, or they would have been breaking this rule. The only place that sheep could be kept, was in the wilderness. Jerusalem, if you don't understand Jerusalem and Bethlehem, here's Jerusalem, 5 miles, say it right, 5 miles south of that is Bethlehem. Most individuals from where they were keeping the sheep are guessing that it was somewhere between a mile and a half, 2 miles north of Bethlehem. So that means you've got sheep being kept in between this area. They would have had to have been kept out here in the wilderness. They wouldn't have been allowed to be kept here unless. The only flocks that could be kept near Jerusalem were flocks that the high priest had already looked at the sheep and blessed them and said they were ready for sacrifice. So all sheep within Jerusalem's area would have had to been sheep that were prepared for temple service, which meant they were destined to be sacrificed. So the shepherds that were watching these sheep were watching sheep that had already been chosen to be sacrificed. So when the angel made the announcement of what was going on, the shepherds standing there, even though they were illiterate, knew exactly what that angel was talking about. So he came at the right time, the right place, and in the right circumstance with a message. The message is the gospel, what we call good news. And I read the verse that I read to you a second ago, but I read it to you this way. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. I have heard this my whole life. I've read these words in the Bible so many times, it's unreal. I turned 65 this year. In a few weeks, I will celebrate my 65th Christmas. This is embedded in my mind. The one who would come and save and change mankind. But two, I will never forget where it landed in my mind, because in 1965, something happened in America that stuck this in my head in a funny way for the rest of my days. How it got stuck in my head. I have something that I love reading. It's called Peanuts. You guys remember Charlie Brown? Big head, striped shirt, and weird dog. Had a little buddy named Linus that had an ever-present security blanket walking around with him. Throughout the whole story of Peanuts, there's this wonderful little lady named Lucy, a weird dog named Snoopy, a little girl named Sally, Pigpen, and all the rest of them. Peppermint Patty was one of my favorites. And every one of them did everything in their power to get Linus to get rid of the blanket. They were never successful. He is the guy in the comic strip of great wisdom, super smart, maturity, and strength. But no matter how bad they picked, they could not get him to let go of that blanket until he simply drops it. And it is burned in my heart, in my head. Because the most powerful thing that affected me as a child was the day that Linus dropped that blanket. He dropped it when he heard the words, "Fear not." I'll never forget it. He walked out onto a stage. Charlie Brown looked at him and basically was going through the thing of Christmas had become so commercial and what was Christmas really about. And he told Charlie Brown, "I'll explain it to you." And he walked out into the middle of that stage with his blanket firm in hand and starts speaking these lines in total seriousness. And when he comes to the end and says, "The angel said, fear not," his hand opens and he drops the blanket on the floor. Those words changed his life and has changed multiple lives ever since then. It's really clear to me that Charles Schultz wasn't simply being brilliant. He chose a certain time to say a certain thing to a nation. The word "fear not" didn't mean you shepherds just need to calm down and quit being anxious. It was to us. What's your fear? What's your blanket? What's the thing that wraps up your life and controls you that you don't drop and you don't put down? So that you finally have the day that when Linus explained the gospel was that God loved man, that he came enough to be born of a woman under Jewish law, and to raise and die and raise again and defeat Frank sin. That's the gospel. They heard it. It embedded in their hearts. The Savior, yes, the Messiah, the Lord's been born today in Bethlehem, the city of David. That to them was the lineage, the one that the Messiah is supposed to go through. And you'll recognize him by this sign. You'll find a baby wrapped snugly in strips of cloth lying in a manger. Suddenly, the angel was joined by a vast host of others, the armies of heaven, praising God and saying. How many of you notice it does not say praising God and singing? It's a big battle amongst Christians when they find out angels don't sing, but that's another subject. They're joined by this vast army of angels saying, not singing, glory to God in the highest heaven and peace on earth to those whom God is pleased. If I could get you just to stop in thought for 1 second. The gospel. Jesus Christ came into this world, please hear me, Jesus Christ came into this world because you, on your own, are a sinner. In words that no one likes hearing in this culture anymore, and because of your sin, you're going to go to hell. Simple. Now, many of you sitting in this room will go, but that's insensitive. It's uncaring. If the Bible is accurate and it says a man goes to hell, how long does he go to hell for? What's forever? I love you. There's many of you sitting in this room that are in your 50s, your 60s, and your 70s, a few of you in your 80s. You're ancient. And I'm not talking about the 80-year-olds, I'm talking about the 50-year-olds. We look back when we were 10 and 20 and 30 and we swore we'd never be here. If you grew up in church, you grew up every single Sunday running down the aisle and there was that 80-year-old guy on his cane and he was barely through the thing and you'd bump into him and go around and he'd take a swap at you with his cane and he didn't have any teeth in his mouth. And now you're there. And the only difference between you and him is since him, they created these things that aren't dentures. They drill things into your mouth and just lock your teeth in there permanent. You're 80 with perfect teeth. I love you. Perfect teeth, dyed hair, stretched skin, implants. And all we're doing is fighting to stay something we're not. I love you. Your fixed teeth standing before a holy God means nothing. Because he's going to look and say, is his name written in the book of life? The book of life was put there because of the gospel story. Jesus died on the cross, was buried, rose again, ascended into heaven so that I could meet my Savior. That's the gospel. Now, can I ask a question real quick? How many of you before you came to this church already had heard that? How many of you have heard it before? The kick is, the next point, do you believe it? Because see, these guys heard it. And they believed it. When the angels had returned to heaven, the shepherds said to each other, let's go to Bethlehem. Let's see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about. So not only did they hear it, they believed it. They sat and said that what just happened in front of us is truth. We accept it as truth. We're guarding the animals that are being sacrificed, and they showed up to us. So we hear it. We believe it. And not only do we hear it and believe it, point number four, and I don't want you to miss this one, they acted on it. And please, when you write that down in your notes that they acted on it, grab one thing that's super, super important in your life. If you truly believe something, you act on it. To say, I heard it and I believe it, but you don't act on it, something's not right. These guys heard it, said, let's go. That means they believed it. They acted on it. They hurried to the village and found Mary and Joseph there, the baby that was there lying in a manger. After seeing him, the shepherds told everyone what had happened and what the angel had said to them about this child. All who heard the shepherd's story was astonished. That's a really good place to stop the story. It would get me out of trouble if I don't say what I'm going to say next. So is everybody ready to go home? I can get through the evening with far less grief. But see, if you hear it, so you know I'm going to go on. If you hear it and you believe it, you have to act on it. And when I say you have to act on it, I was having a conversation with a precious lady before we walked in here tonight. Your Bible, over and over again, James said it and Paul said it again and again and again. I'm going to tell you I believe. You're telling me you believe. But if you believe, act on it. Because if you don't act on it, you don't believe. You're saying something that's really not true. They hurried to Bethlehem to see something because they had heard it was true. After they heard it was true and then saw that it was true, they then went and told everyone. And when we read that, we just go, well, that's just a normal thing that what they did. I shouldn't be writing anything into that when you should be, because the story is powerful because of what they did, because of who they were. They were shepherds. They were despised. They were mistrusted by everyone. They were nobodies. Their job was 24/7 working with sheep. They couldn't stay clean. The laws of the Jews had hand-washing rules. The Jews could obey those rules. The shepherds couldn't, because they were working with dirty animals. In our world that we deal with, we think of sheep, and they're fuzzy, and they're white, and they're cute, and it's that little stuffed animal thing laying on the bed of your kid. How many of you in this room have ever worked with sheep? They stink, they're dirty, they're nasty, they're bleh. And you can't work with them and stay clean. So the shepherds were always unclean in the eyes of the Jewish law. They were also the worst paying job in their culture. Just like in our culture, we can sit down and say, you make money at this job this much, and over at this job this much, and at this job, anyone that works that job makes no money. That was the shepherd's world. They made no money. So everyone considered them as thieves. In fact, a shepherd's reputation was so bad, their laws, so bad that a shepherd was not allowed to testify in a court of law in their thing. If you did something and a shepherd was your defense, you were screwed, because he wasn't allowed to testify. They were considered an individual that would lie naturally. They had no schooling. They couldn't. They were working 24/7 with sheep. They were illiterate. They were poor. They were dirty. And therefore, they were classified as stupid. But you know who's really special? The only group of people that got an invite to see the baby was the no-schooled, illiterate, poor, dirty, stupid shepherds. And that's not what even is profound. What is profound is, in spite of what everyone thought of them, in spite of how many times they were spit on and kicked and beat up, the instant they saw Jesus, it changed them forever. They became different humans. The Bible says the shepherds went back to their flocks, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and all they had seen. It was just as the angel told them. They looked into the face. Please listen to this, Christians. They looked into the face of the Savior, and it changed their lives. They no longer ranked people. They became missionaries and true servants of the great shepherd. His message was one of acceptance. You couldn't be too much of a failure. You couldn't mess up so stinking bad that he wouldn't accept you. He would accept you, and please hear these words, he would accept you and change you. He would accept you and make you different. Please hear me. Everyone in this room that has asked Jesus Christ into your life, please say amen. Amen. You want proof that you've asked Christ into your life? He changes you. I am a 5'10", 198-pound man. At my glory, I was a smidgen off 6 foot. How many of you have noticed the older you get, the more you shrink? I hate life. I have to look at Zach and, you know, look up like this. There's some women in the church I have to look up like that. I don't like you. It's just a bad thing. We get old, we change, we become different. But I remember being this big. I remember keeping the pews underneath the churches that I grew up in clean. It wasn't carpet, it was tile. The janitor never had to sweep it because we slid back and forth underneath it. They never had to keep the pews clean. We didn't have padded ones. They were that way because we as little kids would get on this end and slide down to that end. It seems like yesterday in my life. It wasn't yesterday. There's a lot of yesterdays ago. So see, just like I can go, I've changed. My nails aren't as hard, they're brittle. But you know how fast they grow. You know how fast your hair grows or doesn't grow. You can judge everything in life by physically, more belly or less, stronger teeth or less. You can judge everything by growth or no growth. Can I be honest with you? If I can judge physical, then can't I judge spiritual? Can't I say, I know when a baby's born, it's normal. I was there. One of them, mine that I love, is in the room, Brianna. I was there when she was born. My wife said, when they put Frankie in your arms, it was like, oh, it's a guy. You can drop him. It doesn't hurt. They handed her to me as a little girl and put her in my arms, and my whole world changed. I fell in love instantaneously. And she's an adult woman with kids of her own. I've watched her grow every day of her life. I can judge growth, that it grew to a certain height. Her world, not so much, but it grew to a certain height. Grew to a certain beauty. Grew to a certain look. Met a man that he was blessed that I didn't kill him. And they're married and they have kids. Can't we judge that? So see, spiritually, we can go, I asked Jesus into my life at this time. So from here to here, there should be spiritual growth. I should be able to go, I met Christ here, I have grown to here. If I say I met Christ here, as Paul and James said, I will show you I believe by what comes out of my life. If nothing comes out of your life, you've not met the Savior. You had a religious experience. Zippeduah. That which is born again, you know you've been born again because you watch the growth and you watch the change and you feel him working in your life and you see the stuff that he does. The shepherds changed instantly. They went from being people that everyone kicked on and everyone spit on and everyone hated their guts and everyone deemed them as crooks. They looked into the face of Jesus and they instantaneously became different human beings who went to everyone that mistreated them and said, the Messiah has been born in Bethlehem. The Christ child, the one we have waited for our whole life, is here. And they could have kept it to themselves. Instead, they said no. They turned into something that was love. They turned into something that was deep. I love this verse. When I look at the night sky and see the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars that you set in place, shepherds had all kind of time to do that. While everyone else was in bed sleeping, multiple of them were sitting out on the hill watching the sheep. On that off chance that a wolf or a lion or a bear would come in and they would have to lay their life down to protect the sheep. But night after night after night, nothing went on. You ever do that? How many of you take a dog out late at night? How many of you have to do that late at night? Is it just the same repetitious nonsense every single night? The other night I'm standing there, my little dachshund goes out. You understand that the little dachshund is Robin's little dachshund? Have you ever been faced with a choice? Little dachshund went out, and it's doing a little thing that little dachshunds and dogs do, and I'm sitting there with a flashlight on it because it's a black dog and you can't see it if it's dark. And I'm just standing there looking and waiting, and I hear a noise, and I look up about 25 feet away from the dachshund, and I shine the light, and there's two red things looking at me. And I went, Butkus, what are you doing over there? And behind me I heard, hmm. And I realized there was a group of coyotes standing 25 feet away from my dog looking at it. I now had to make a choice. If they're really hungry, they could take the dog and ruin 95% of, you know, my wife's feelings, but make me so happy. And then I went, wow, a coyote would really look good on the wall. So I pulled my gun and they were gone. And see, that's the life a shepherd lived. I have taken dogs out in that house for 23 years. That's the first time I've ever walked out and looked 25 feet away from a coyote who was eyeing the dachshund and thought it looked like a hot dog. So see, most of the night, shepherds just stood there and looked at the stars. And have you ever noticed when you spend time not listening to nonsense, not something plugged in your head, and looking at the stars, that by standing there looking at the stars and the moon, that something happens in your heart? That you just start thinking of the awesomeness of God? Who are we, mere mortals, that you as God would think about us? Humans. Who are we? See, the shepherds changed. They became different. Their love was no longer conditional. This is the most powerful word you'll ever hear used in the Christian walk. Our life is supposed to be about service. We are supposed to use our Christian life every day to serve. Not to whine about it, not to gripe about it, not complain about it. The church doesn't need more people who think they're leaders. It needs more people who know they're servants. We need more people in the church where the church doesn't put up with the garbage that 90% of the people in the church set there while 10% of the body does the work. You guys all understand what that means, right? My daughter Brianna is sitting here. She leads our children's ministry. Brianna's not sitting here a lot because Brianna has to substitute regularly for teachers that are sick. You should be those substitutes. Brianna teaches regularly. You should go to her and say, I will serve anywhere I have to serve. I don't care if I'm 80 years old. I can beat children with a cane if you need me to. You should serve. You should serve without complaining, without griping, without whining, without saying, I'm the only one that does it, no one else does it. You should break your back serving God since He broke His back serving you. Everyone who agrees, say amen. Why will the church say amen to that? But when it comes to serving other Christians who don't like act like other Christians, it bothers us. Why can't we embrace the lifestyle of serving and loving and caring even for people who live in sin and do things contrary to the Word of God? Why can't we serve and break our backs loving and caring for people who are of a different political party than we are, or who wear masks, or who felt they needed to be vaccinated? Why can't we love and serve and care and break our back for individuals who make fun of us for what we believe? You get that the reason why the church is, why the church in America is dying is because the church in America is hiding itself in little huddle groups, in little buildings all across this area of 10 people and 20 people and 30 people in auditoriums that seat 300 and 400 people that used to have their glory days as how big the church was, and today their church is nothing and they don't want anyone coming in the building because it might dare mess up the way they've been doing things. You understand that? The world is on its way to hell while the church gripes about it instead of winning mankind to Jesus. That's what happened to the shepherds. They were nobodies in the field taking care of sheep, and they became the first missionaries on the planet when they saw Jesus and said, my job is about changing everyone around me, and I will work myself to death to make that happen, and I will take my vacation, and I will quit and be done when my Savior calls me home. Because the vacation you're going to get in heaven is going to be millions upon millions upon millions upon millions upon millions of years. How many of you think in heaven you can get a long enough vacation that you'll be okay? They have deer hunting in heaven. How many of you know that? They do. I've said it multiple times in services. The only difference is the deer in heaven can shoot back. Amen? They have football in heaven. Would you like to play a team of angels? So in closing tonight, that's what Christmas is, guys. It's taking my life in your life and doing exactly what the shepherds did. The message became real to the world around them because they served the world around them. And that first Christmas was life-changing, just like every Christmas is supposed to be. Got it? Good. Father, thank you for bringing us here tonight. I, with everything inside of me, Lord, wouldn't dare want to make any human feel like I'm picking on specifically them. All of us need to understand that a group of shepherds changed the world. A message that was accepted by shepherds and fishermen rearranged all of life. You came at the right time, in the right place, and in the right circumstances to change our world. That change means we become servants of yours. And we are to break everything inside of us to bring a world that doesn't know love and doesn't know compassion and doesn't know you. And we are to do whatever we can do to move hell and earth to see a world change. Use this message in each one of our lives tonight, God. Well, I really thank you for the music tonight, the message, and what it did to each one of our lives. And I ask these things in your name, Jesus. Amen.
Yeah.
Come on, church. Hey, I can't believe it's already Christmas time. Can you? And we get to have a great time just getting ready for Christmas. And don't forget, tomorrow's our 25th anniversary. You guys feeling good? You feeling good? You feeling alive? Not just this side of the room, this side too. You feeling good? Because I can always bank on good answers from right here over here. They know this. This is my hallelujah choir over here. Hallelujah. But then I got over here some people that just give me the good old smile. So God is good. Amen. Let's all stand. Tell somebody how much you love them. 25th anniversary tomorrow, 5 o'clock. 5 o'clock. Get there. Have a great time. Dress up. Dress fancy or what you got. It doesn't matter. We're going to have a great time and loving on people. But go be the church. You are dismissed.